Good afternoon. I'm Dr Tushar, Consultant Internal Medicine, CK Birla Hospital for Women and Men. Today, I'll be talking about common monsoon illnesses. What are the organisms causing these illnesses? How they spread? What measures you can take to prevent it? And what common medicines you can take to get relief in your symptoms? Like we all know, every year with the onset of monsoons, a lot of people tend to fall sick. Somebody is suffering from viral fever, somebody may have dengue, somebody has typhoid. Why does it happen? It happens so because during monsoons, the weather conditions are very ambient for the growth of viruses, bacteria and mosquitoes. How do these illnesses spread? So your common flu or viral fever, it spreads through droplet infection. When you cough, you produce droplets which contain the virus. When they land on somebody else, that person can also get the infection. Dengue, malaria and chikungunya, they spread due to mosquito bites, whereas typhoid, your gastroenteritis and jaundice happens because of eating infected food. So what common measures can you take to prevent the spread of these diseases are: avoid eating out too much, make sure that you are eating at hygienic places, avoid eating at roadside stalls and vendors. Have a lot of water, but make sure that the water that you're drinking is RO water or boiled water. Prevent the breeding of mosquitoes around your house by getting insecticide sprayed. Use mosquito repellents, wear full sleeve clothes. And also you can take vaccines for certain illnesses, which we'll be discussing once we discuss those particular illnesses. Today we'll be talking about viral fever, dengue, typhoid and gastroenteritis. So let us start with the commonest illness, which every second person nowadays is seeming to have, which is viral fever. As the name implies, viral fever happens due to a virus. Why that is important? Because you should know that viruses are antibiotics do not work on viruses. So my request to everybody would be, do not take an antibiotic tablet as soon as you get fever, because most of the infections are viral fevers and the antibiotic will not help you. What are the symptoms of viral fever? The symptoms of viral fever are high-grade fever for the first 3 days of the illness. The fever may be as high as 102 to 103 degree Fahrenheit. Body ache, headache. You may have throat irritation or throat pain. You may have cough which may be dry or which may be productive. Also, you may have running nose or nasal congestion. What medications can you take to get relief in your symptoms? These are, you can take tablet paracetamol, 650 milligram tablet. You can take it every 4 to 5 hour day. The maximum dose of paracetamol in a day is 4 grams per day. So that makes it around 5 to 6 tablets in a day. That is one tablet every 4 to 5 hours, provided your liver function is normal. Along with paracetamol, you can also take, if you have running nose or nasal congestion, in that case, you can take any antihistaminic such as cetirizine or fexofenadine. If you have dry cough or if you have cough, in that case, you can take any over-the-counter cough syrup for dry cough such as, say, Corex, DX, Alex, Rapitus, etc. If you have sore throat, you can do saltwater gargles and betadine gargles. Sometimes antibiotics are given in flus. When is that? When, if on examination of your throat, the throat has a lot of pus points, your tonsils are congested, or the fever persists at high grade beyond 3 days, or the phlegm that you are producing is very dark yellow or dark greenish in color. Why am I insisting so much that you should not take antibiotics during an acute episode of illness? Is because many other illnesses such as typhoid as well as dengue fever can present with similar symptoms. In particular, typhoid is a bacterial illness. It requires antibiotics for treatment. So say you're suffering from typhoid fever and not viral fever, the initial presenting symptoms are going to be the same. But in case you take an antibiotic on the first day of the illness, then the diagnosis and the treatment of typhoid becomes difficult. So hence, avoid taking unnecessary antibiotics. Make sure that you keep yourself hydrated, take closing on the clock, take some antihistaminic, cough syrup, etc. Ideally, in a normal viral fever, the symptoms last for 5 days. For the first 3 days of the illness, the fever is high. After 3 days, the fever starts settling down, and after 5 days, the fever completely goes away. So if in any fever, if the fever persists at a high grade beyond 3 days, then there's a possibility that you might have something else other than a simple viral fever. Another thing that you can do is to take a flu vaccine, which comes by the name of Influvax or Flu Quadri, in the month of September. It protects you against common flu, as well as it also gives you some protection against swine flu, which happens during winter seasons. I think this is all about viral fever. We'll talk about the next disease we'll be talking about is typhoid. Typhoid is another illness which is very common in rainy seasons. It happens due to eating contaminated food and water. The food, it generally happens when you eat outside, and it happens if your food gets infected by the feces of somebody who's already typhoid positive. Generally happens when a person who's handling your food has typhoid, doesn't wash his or her hands properly and touches your food, or it can get transmitted due to flies. The symptoms of typhoid fever are high grade fever. The pattern of typhoid fever is a stepladder fever. In the morning the fever will be less, and by the end of the day the fever goes on increasing and is very high by the end of the day. Next morning again the fever is low and goes on increasing during the day. Along with fever, you may have headache, body ache, stomach discomfort, and generally there's constipation, but sometimes there can be diarrhea also. The diagnosis of typhoid fever is done with the help of blood tests, which is blood culture, which ideally should be done before taking any antibiotic. If you have taken any antibiotic and then you do the blood culture test, then the result of the blood culture might be negative or it might be incorrect. Another test that we use to do test typhoid is Vidal. Vidal is generally done on the 7th day of the fever. So a lot of times patients come to us and they've already done their test, they've already done the Vidal test before 7 days. In that case also, the result of the Vidal can be incorrect or false. The treatment of typhoid fever is with the help of antibiotics. The antibiotics are to be taken for a long duration, sometimes from 10 to 14 days. So make sure that if you are diagnosed with typhoid, you take the entire course of antibiotics, otherwise there's a chance of relapse. Other than that, for fever, you can continue taking paracetamol round the clock. If you have nausea or vomiting, in that case, you can take a tablet of ondansetron, 4 milligrams SOS, or you can take a combination of pantocid or pantoprazole or aripiprazole with domperidone, which will take care of your acidity and nausea. Again, make sure that you hydrate yourself well. Take a lot of water. Another category of people in whom typhoid is very common is people who regularly take acidity medication. You know, Pandi and Razodi. Why is it so? Because these medicines stop the production of acid in your stomach. So in normal person, if they're eating food, even which might have the typhoid bacteria, if it goes into your stomach, the acid kills that bacteria. But in a person who's taking pantocid and all these medicines, and when they take that food which might have bacteria, there's no acid and the bacteria does not get killed and can produce diseases. In people who frequently get typhoid infection or who are prone to getting typhoid infection, a vaccine can be taken. There is an injectable as well as oral vaccine for typhoid, and the effect generally lasts for 2 to 3 years. Hydration is the key again, and taking a proper antibiotic course, whatever has been prescribed by your doctor. The next illness that we'll be talking about is gastroenteritis or diarrhea. Again, happens due to eating outside food, and the symptoms are watery stools. Multiple times in a day, the stools can be watery or semi-solid. It may or may not be associated with abdominal pain. There may be nausea, there may be associated vomiting, and there may be fever. The fever generally which happens along with diarrhea is low grade, but if there is a very high grade fever along with loose stools, in that case, there is a possibility that you might even have typhoid. Diarrhea can happen either due to virus or bacteria both, but the good news is that these are very self-limiting diseases, and you need not take too many antibiotics or too many medicines to get better. The key point to remember in a person who has diarrhea is to maintain hydration. Every time you pass stools, make sure that you have at least 200 ml of water or fluids or shikanji or buttermilk or coconut water. So if you've had stools 4 times, you have to have at least 1 liter of water intake to maintain hydration. Along with that, you can take some probiotic capsules such as Visilac, Bifilac, Darolac 2 to 3 times in a day. If there is nausea, vomiting, in that case you can take ondansetron 4 mg tablet as and when needed. Again, you can take a combination of Pantocid plus Domperidone or Abiprazole plus Domperidone once or twice a day for your acidity and for your nausea. But the key to treatment of diarrhea is lots and lots of fluids. Some people who come to the OPD, they mention that, you know, they had diarrhea, they went to the chemist and took a tablet of Roco or Imodium to stop their loose stools. I would not recommend that you should do that. You should avoid taking that tablet. Why so? Because these tablets, what they do is they stop the movement of your intestines. So as long as you're getting motion, the infection is coming out of your body. But once you take these tablets, the movement of your intestine stops and the infection can get spread in your body and can become more serious for you. So do not take that. These medicines are only indicated if you have a viral diarrhea, and that we can only come to know based on your tests or based on your symptoms when you consult a doctor. But yes, make sure that you keep on having lots of fluids, maintain hydration. The foods that you have to avoid if you have diarrhea are milk and salads, or basically raw foods. You can have fruits, but make sure that you peel them properly or wash them properly. Make sure that you have a lot of buttermilk, curd, potatoes, rice, curd rice, and bananas. I think that is all about diarrhea. Next we'll be talking about is dengue. Every year, as soon as the monsoon set in, we hear that a lot of people are suffering from dengue. Dengue is caused by a virus which spreads with the bite of mosquitoes. The mosquito is Aedes mosquito, and it generally bites during the morning or during the daytime. It breeds in clean water, so make sure that you avoid accumulation of water in your houses. Please empty those money plant bottles if you have, and empty your coolers, because these are the places where the mosquito breeds. The symptoms between the bite of the mosquito and the onset of the fever can be as long as 7 to 10 days. And the symptoms of dengue are very similar to what viral fever is initially, that is high grade fever, but the fever can go as high up till 104-105 degree Fahrenheit, along with severe headache, severe bodyache and backache. There may be eye pain, there may be abdominal pain associated with nausea and vomiting. The thing that you have to know is, again, since dengue is a viral fever, there is no role of antibiotics, and symptomatic treatment is the key to treatment of dengue. And not every dengue patient has to get admitted. Just because a person has been diagnosed with dengue doesn't mean that we have to admit the patient. With simple symptomatic treatment also, the patient can recover at home. What do you have to do in dengue? See, what happens in dengue is basically the water from the blood, it starts leaking out from your vessels and starts accumulating in your abdomen, in your lungs. Because of which the blood becomes very thick. There's no water in the blood, so it becomes very thick. So the symptoms of dengue are because of the thickness of the blood. That is why we recommend that you should hydrate yourself well. So make sure that you're having a lot of water. Another thing, you can take paracetamol tablet around the clock, every 4 to 5 hours, like I mentioned before. The maximum dose of paracetamol, like I said, is 4 grams in a day, provided your liver function is normal. Do not try to exceed that. If you have nausea, vomiting, you can take Pantocid, Domperidone and Ondansetron. If you have itching over the body, in that case, you can take a tablet of Allegra or Cetirizine. What are the warning signs in dengue? When should you be careful that, you know, it is something which is serious? If a person has high-grade fever which is not coming down with medicines at all, one. If the patient becomes drowsy or becomes unresponsive, two. If the patient starts bleeding from any part, that is, you know, the patient has black-colored stools, blood in the urine, blood in the vomiting, blood in the vomitus, blood in the phlegm, the bloody bleeding from the gums when you're brushing your teeth, or a red spot in the eye. That is a warning sign that the platelet might be low and the patient might require urgent admission. But the key to treatment of dengue again is hydration and a lot of water and tablet paracetamol round the clock. Generally in dengue, for the first 5 days, the fever remains high. On the fifth day of the fever, the fever starts subsiding, and that is the time when you develop a rash over your body. The thing that you have to remember in dengue again is that once the fever starts settling down, that is the time when the platelets tend to fall, and that is the time when we have to be more cautious for the next 2 to 3 days that the platelets should not be falling. and then that is the time when we monitor the platelets aggressively. After 7 to 8 days of the illness, the platelets start recovering normally and the virus is out of your body. A lot of people also try home remedies such as papide ka pani and giloy ka pani and bakri ka dood. So there is no scientific evidence to whether these things actually help or not. They may not be, but medically we do not recommend it. But if you want to try these things, you can do it. I think this is all about dengue. The last disease we'll be talking about is jaundice. Again, very common during monsoon seasons, happens due to intake of infected food and water. It is a viral illness. Again, there is no role of antibiotics in jaundice. Happens because of either hepatitis A virus or hepatitis E virus. The symptoms are fever, which might be low grade to high grade for 3 to 4 days. And after that, the patient notices that there is yellowish discoloration of the eyes or the urine is very yellow in color. Generally, the patient comes with these symptoms that I have fever and I have very yellow colored urine. The diagnosis is done with the help of blood tests, in which we do LFT, and that is diagnostic of whether the person has jaundice or not. Again, since it is a viral infection, there is no role of antibiotics. The treatment is again paracetamol for your fever, but since hepatitis is a disease of the liver, make sure that you don't take a very high dose of paracetamol, maybe 2 to 3 tablets in a day. The fever should start settling down in 4 to 5 days of your illness. In jaundice, what happens is, once the fever settles, then the yellowish coloration of your eyes and the urine increases, and there may be associated nausea, vomiting along with that. Do not get worried about the yellowishness of the urine. It increases and gradually it starts settling down. The yellowishness might even last for say 2 weeks to 3 weeks after the fever settles down. But that does not mean that the illness is there in your body. It is a natural process of the body and it slowly eliminates that bilirubin from your body. Some people also believe that if you have jaundice, you can't have yellow fruits, you can't have haldi. That is absolutely baseless. There is no recommendation that you can't have anything which is yellow in color. You can eat everything, but make sure that it is cooked properly and make sure that you have plenty of water. So I think this in all kind of covers most of the common monsoon illnesses. If you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer. And if you want any topic to be discussed in the future, do let us know and probably we can have a session on that again.
There are a few questions by our viewers, Doctor.
Yeah.
The first one is how to tackle frequent acidity episode. Also, do eating having heavy foods such as oily or spicy after a long gap meals triggers acidity.
So, irregular timings, food timings are the primary causative agents of acidity. But sometimes. It could be simply because you're having irregular timings, you're sleeping late, etc. That is causing you acid reflux. But sometimes there could be if you have a chronic problem of acidity which has been going on for months or years altogether, then there could be something intrinsic which might be causing it. There are different causes. Sometimes there's a bacteria in your stomach which is known as H. pylori, which can cause excessive acid production and which causes acidity. Sometimes there's a condition which is known as hiatus hernia, in which a part of your stomach kind of goes into your chest, which can also contribute to acidity. So if it is a small, it is a symptom of a short duration where you've been having it for a very short time, that is possibly because of your lifestyle. Improve your lifestyle. If required, you can take an over-the-counter medicine such as ranitidine, which comes by the name of Acilok or Rantac, or you could take a PPI such as pantoprazole or rabeprazole for a couple of days. Do not try to take it for a very long period of time because prolonged use of acidity medication decreases the absorption of calcium B12 in your body, and like I mentioned before, it makes you more prone to developing typhoid. If it persists, make sure that you visit your doctor and you might even require an endoscopy.
Another question, Doctor. Gradually, I have developed morning cold. What should I do for it? I am an sinus patient too. This question is asked by Peshali Sharma.
Again, a morning cold, and if you have a history of sinus, that then possibility you might be having what is known as chronic sinusitis and chronic inflammation of your sinuses. Again, we do not know, probably there is a deviated septum or what is the primary cause, we do not know. There's another condition which is known as allergic rhinitis, in which your nose is very sensitive to stimuli such as dust, pollen, etc., which can frequently cause you sinus infection or nasal inflammation. One thing that you can do, especially during weather changes when there's too much of pollen, is that you can take an anti-allergic such as cetirizine or montelukast once at bedtime if your symptoms are more during those periods. You could also try nasal sprays which have anti-allergics and a mild steroid such as deodorant nasal spray, which you could take twice a day for a couple of weeks, and that could also help in settling your symptoms. But make sure that you do it under the supervision of a doctor. Do not take it just over the counter.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you so much. Take care. Stay healthy.